Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Center for Muslim Christian Understanding. I'm John Brown. I'm the director of the Al-Walid Law Center for Muslim Christian Understanding. And that's all you need to know about me. We have a very interesting speaker today. Dr. Mayanthi Fernando is Associate Professor of Anthropology at the University of California at Santa Cruz. If anyone's ever been there, it is beautiful.
Banana slugs.
Yes. It's on like, it looks like a ranch or something.
It was a ranch.
It's a ranch by the beach with a bunch of people surfing. And so anyway, that's all I'll say. She's very fortunate to be a professor there. And she's in the anthropology department. Her first book, The Republic Unsettled, Muslim, French, and the Contradiction of Secularism, Duke University Press, 2014, addresses the intersection of religion and politics in contemporary France. She's recently begun to work on law, embodiment, and sex, gender norms of secularity. When I first invited her to come, I can't remember if it was in the summer, there was different things in the news. Now there's other things in the news. But I think that if there's one thing that's always been in the news, it's how the problems for and around Muslim minorities in Western countries. And so this is, her book is one of the more sophisticated books of this. I really recommend it. It's very readable and you'll learn a lot from it. So please, she's gonna talk for half an hour or so and then we'll have plenty of time for Q&A. Thank you and welcome.
Thank you, Jonathan. So, and the center for, and Kristen for all this logistical help and making everything run smoothly. Can you all hear me if I talk like this? Okay. I think I'm supposed to stand up here.
But
so.
We can't see you.
No, yeah.
Oh.
That's life.
I mean.
We'll have to get a smaller light in here.
And there's no light here, is there?
I don't think so.
It doesn't matter. So I want to begin by taking you back to a moment from my fieldwork in France. It was April 2003, and I was at the annual Congress of the Union of Islamic Organizations of France, or UOIF, a four-day event that attracted about 80,000 people that year. And this is the poster from the conference. On April 20th, Farid Abdelkrim took the conference stage. Abdelkrim was a founding member and former president of the Young Muslims of France, or JMF, Jeunes Musulmans de France, one of the satellite organizations of the UOIF dedicated to youth issues. Built like a rugby player and dressed neatly in a black shirt and black trousers, Farid immediately established a sense of familiarity with his public, alternating between joking self-deprecation and an aggressive, sometimes haranguing exhortation of the audience. And that was his style offstage, I discovered as well. That Sunday afternoon, Farid invoked his dead father, who had come from a small village in Algeria, to work for the National Railway as a rail track layer. He spoke eloquently and forcefully about the need for historical memory, reminding his audience that our parents built this country on their backs. He then turned to the present day. "Stop talking to me about integration," he thundered to wild applause. "I'm here and I'm French. France is my homeland. The Republic is mine. La France est mon bled. La République est la mienne." The huge crowd roared in appreciation, and many people, most of them in their early 20s and 30s, rose to give Farid a standing ovation. Farid ended his speech with the booming call for civic and political action. Engagement, engagement, engagement. My talk today is an attempt to think through a new future in these very, very dark times. It heeds Farid's demand to stop talking about integration, a demand echoed by many Muslim French, even as the framework of integration and Muslim supposed lack of integration remains the most common way for politicians and scholars to think about Islam in France. Instead, I want to take seriously the claims made by Farid and other Muslim French that France is their homeland, their bled, and to think about the political imagination and sense of citizenship that accompanies that claim. By Muslim French, I mean a generation of young people, many of them the children and sometimes grandchildren of Maghrebi laborers, like Farid's father, recruited to rebuild France in the period after World War II. Muslim French are those committed to practicing Islam as French citizens and to practicing French citizenship as pious Muslims. As I will show, Muslim French refuse to relegate what they consider a fundamental aspect of their identity, their Muslimness, to the private sphere, asserting their right to be piously and visibly Muslim in the public sphere. They do so, and this is what makes them distinct from their parents' generation, they do so by defining their Muslimness as always already French. Moreover, by making the relationship between Muslimness and Frenchness coextensive, Muslim French imagine new ways of organizing the national polity, envisioning a future for France that does not constrain Muslimness to the space of difference. We should not forget, of course, that Muslim French make these claims to France within and against a legal, political, and discursive context in which Muslims are figured as threats to French national identity, and Muslim essentially means not French. Yet, even if this Muslim French political imagination remains at the level of aspiration, I nonetheless find it productive to think with, especially now, to see my interlocutors as political theorists of the future, to use my ethnography of Muslim French civic activists as an occasion to reflect on citizenship, public religiosity, and political possibility in France and perhaps elsewhere too. Sorry, I probably should get a glass. The claims that Muslim French make to France and the grounding of those claims in the paradigm of citizenship, oops, sorry, I forgot the slide. Anyway, that's Farid's point. The claims that Muslim French make to France and the grounding of those claims in the paradigm of citizenship, thank you, oops, were strikingly displayed during a December 2003 demonstration against the then proposed law banning headscarves in public schools. About 3,000 or 4,000 demonstrators, mostly young women, many of them clad in blue, white, and red headscarves, marched from the Place de la République to the Place de la Bastille, chanting slogans and holding placards, all in French. One sign read, "School, my path, the veil, my choice, France, my right. Le voile, mon choix, l'école, mon voix, la France, mon droit." A number of the young women held aloft their national identity cards and their voter registration cards, the practical tools of active citizenship. Some of the young women at the head of the cortege had faded French flags wrapped around poles in the fashion of the revolutionary period. As we approached the Bastille, a message rippled through the crowd. The few hundred men were told to get out of the procession as the women were going to storm the Bastille, whereupon a number of young women climbed atop the base of the gilded column that marks the site of the former prison, the storming of which symbolically constitutes the founding moment of the Revolutionary Republic. That gesture of inscribing Muslims into the founding moment of the Republic was repeated in 2012 by the Collective Against Islamophobia in France in its "Nous sommes aussi la nation," we are also the nation, campaign. One of the images in a series of advertisements reimagines painter Jacques-Louis David's Revolution-era tennis court oath. The oath was a pledge signed by members of the Third Estate, refusing to disband until a new constitution had been written, the first time French citizens formally stood in opposition to Louis XVI. The new image depicts the tennis court oath in the present, with veiled women, Arab men in hoodies, and visibly Orthodox Jews, among other citizens, holding aloft French flags and copies of the oath. The image does not merely represent, but also enacts the Muslim French claim to France as a right of citizenship, depicting Muslims as original revolutionary citizens. This Muslim French claim to France also entails a concerted effort to Frenchify or franciser the Islamic tradition institutionally, exegetically, and culturally. Franciser was a term used by Mounia and Shiraz, two sisters in their late 20s whose parents had emigrated from Tunisia to the city of Nantes in the 1960s. The sisters had created an innovative head covering that looks less like a traditional headscarf and more like a soft cloth fedora with a neck scarf attached. In explaining the motivation for their sartorial creation, Mounia claimed that it was a way to adapt and to integrate. Shiraz disagreed vehemently. "What am I integrating into? I'm French," she said. Mounia, and Shiraz is on the your right and Mounia is on the left. Mounia contended that Shiraz had misunderstood her point, that though covering the head, neck, and ears remains an obligation for Muslim women, the precise form that covering takes can be culturally specific. Muslim French women therefore needed to franciser the headscarf. "We're not in Iran, we're not in Egypt, we're not in Tunisia, we're in France," Mounia said. She was not arguing that Muslims are not integrated into French society and need to adapt, a common refrain among non-Muslims, but rather that because practicing Muslims like her are already French, they need to act like it and not adopt dress styles from the Middle East or the Maghreb. Munoz's reasoning draws implicitly on one of the major interpretive trends within the modernist and reformist currents of the contemporary Islamic revival, namely the abstraction of Islam into the site of fundamental principles and universal values like justice, equality, and rationality that are instantiated differently in different historical and cultural contexts. This position is best exemplified in Europe by scholar and theologian Tariq Ramadan, who himself draws on a much longer interpretive tradition concerning the dynamic relationship between divine law, sharia, and its human articulation, fiqh. Ramadan contends that although Islam is universal, indeed because Islam is universal, and I quote, there should be an Islam rooted in the cultural universe of Europe. Islam and its Islamic references is one and unique. The methods of judicial application are, however, differentiated, and its concretization in a given place and a given time is by nature plural, unquote. Interestingly, by making Islam the site of the universal, Ramadan also locates France as the site of the particular, of culture, thereby turning on its head the common secular republican paradigm in which France is universal and Islam particular as culture, race, or religion. According to Ramadan's framework, there exists no incompatibility between being French and being Muslim because those French values that are universal, liberty, equality, and fraternity, for example, are already encompassed by the Islamic tradition, and those that are particular, i.e. particular cultural practices and particular instantiations of the universal, are already shared by Muslims by dint of their being French. Importantly, these Muslim-French claims to France do not imply a break with the past. Recall Farid's declaration that La France est mon bled, a declaration with various layers of meaning. Bled is an Arabic word that means both village and homeland. On the face of it, then, by declaring France his bled, Farid was making a strong claim of national belonging, averring that France, rather than Algeria, is his homeland, and marking a clear distinction between the national cultural sensibilities of his parents' generation, whose bled is overseas, and his own generation, whose bled is very much France. Yet even as he makes this distinction, his use of the term bled simultaneously Arabizes France, foregrounding the historical entanglements back and forth across the Mediterranean. Muslim French thus ground their claim to France, France my right, France mon droit, not only in their birth and education there, but also in the fact that their grandparents fought and died in France's colonial armies during the World Wars, as well as in the fact that their parents worked to rebuild metropolitan France in the aftermath of World War II. Recall Farid's phrasing, our parents built this country on their backs. Farid once pointed out that individuals like him were not present in France by accident. It's not like we got lost along the way. On ne s'est pas trompé de route, he said. People have to realize that, and France has to assume its destiny. By reconnecting French colonial history to the nation's present and future, Muslim French like Farid turned their ancestors into an integral part of France's national genealogy, and in so doing, turned themselves into the rightful heirs of France. To reweave the histories of France and Algeria is therefore not simply to make a historical claim, but also to reconceptualize the present and the future of France. The historicity built into Muslim French politics also presupposes a futurity. France does not simply have to assume its past, but also, as Farid noted, its destiny. The two are ineluctably linked. Thus, the aim of Muslim French attention to France's colonial genealogy is not, as many secular Republicans anxiously and angrily contend, to make the Republic atone for its past, but rather to enable all French to imagine the present and the future more capaciously. By conjuring forth a new political imagination for the future, one that emerges out of the historical and contemporary realities of France, Muslim French implicitly reversed the accusation of communalism or neo-tribalism, communautarisme, that is consistently directed at them by mainstream French Republican politicians and scholars. Through this reversal, Republicans become those with a meager grasp of history, a narrow understanding of community, and consequently an impoverished political imagination. the French Republican tradition, we should remember, constitutes itself and its authority by establishing a powerful sense of political and cultural continuity of French identity over time, positing an unbroken link that stretches back to Jean-Jacques Rousseau and sometimes all the way back to Charlemagne. A 2006 book titled Proud to be French, Fier d'être Français, by the novelist and popular historian Max Gallo, for example, begins with an epigraph from the medieval epic poem Chanson de Roland to produce a continuous notion of France stretching to the 11th century. Such continuity erases the purposeful construction of modern France through various military, political, and legal operations. We should remember that until the mid-19th century, most people in France refused to identify with the nation. They held onto village loyalties and spoke regional languages rather than French. The idea of France as a homogeneous and historically continuous nation is a fiction. Yet the sense of continuity so often invoked enables Republicans to posit the Republican model of citizenship, which ostensibly does not recognize any subnational differences and disallows public expressions of communal attachment, to posit this model as essentially French. By undoing this continuity, or to be more precise, by radically expanding it to such an extent that continuity and rupture become difficult to disentangle, Muslim French like Farid do two things. First, they disrupt the familiar story told not just across the political spectrum in France, but in much scholarly work as well. They disrupt the familiar story that Muslims are new arrivals via post-colonial immigration. Muslim French attention to history forces us to remember that Muslims have long been present in France and, moreover, integral to its development. Scholars have shown how modern France and its colonial outposts were constituted together, with the colonies often serving as blueprints or staging grounds for forms of modern government in the metropole. Significantly, from 1830 to 1962, Algeria and its population of Muslims was an essential part of France. Algeria was not a protectorate, overseas department, or territory governed by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, like many other colonies, but rather a series of départements akin to other metropolitan departments. Second, Muslim French disrupt the conventional narrative that the French legal and political system is unitary. After all, legal pluralism, understood as anathema to republican secularism, legal pluralism flourished in Algeria, which had separate legal systems for Kabyles, Arab Muslims, and Jews, a situation deemed entirely compatible at the time with political republicanism. In fact, the entire French Empire functioned through a variegated legal and political system. Not only were imperial outposts like Indochina, Algeria, Senegal, Mauritius, Guadeloupe, Pondicherry, and Tahiti, they were all governed differently from each other, but even within a single political unit, distinct legal regimes applied to distinct populations. Colonial Algeria was not unique in this way. And even in France, even in the present, France is not one, and this applies to its much-vaunted model of secularism, or laïcité. In the northeast region of Alsace-Moselle, for example, the 1905 law separating church and state never went into effect, and the region continues to be governed by the Napoleonic-era concordat system, with four recognized religions subsidized by the state, not Islam, though. Muslim French attention to history undercuts the narrative of a republic one and indivisible. And in so doing, Muslim French interrupt the tight relation between contemporary republican politics and Frenchness, refusing to cede control of the definition of authentic French citizenship to secular republicans. Indeed, one major element of this historicist futurist project of reconfiguring France, of imagining citizenship otherwise, entails the normalization of the practice of Islam, including its public practice, as simply one more way of being French. Note the precise nature of this reconfiguration. Muslim French like Farid, Mounia, and Shiraz do not simply contend that one can be both French and Muslim, that practicing Islam and being a French citizen are compatible. Rather, Muslim French make the more radical claim that Muslim is French. By claiming that Muslim is French, Muslim French put into question any neat separation between public and private, politics and religion, and universal and particular, separations that republican citizenship and French secularism both constantly demand and consistently contravene. In so doing, they also propose a new political horizon, making it possible to imagine as equally French, other ways of organizing the polity. And in fact, and this is what I want to focus on for the rest of the talk, one of the effects of this reimagining of France by Muslim French is a reimagining of the relationship between difference and citizenship. Public expressions of Muslimness, as well as demands like those for state-funded Muslim private schools, the right to wear headscarves in public schools, and for the incorporation of Muslim holy days into the national school calendar, are usually interpreted by politicians and public intellectuals in France and elsewhere as demands for the recognition and institutional accommodation of Muslim difference. Most French Republicans believe these demands contravene both French secularism and French citizenship. While this contingent dominates public debate in France, a number of other figures have drawn on Canadian political philosopher Charles Taylor's influential notion of the politics of recognition to call for a more inclusive republic, less repressive of difference. These latter figures argue that the best political framework for dealing with Muslim minorities entails the public recognition and accommodation of Muslim difference. Yet many of my Muslim French interlocutors rejected the paradigm of difference. Farid did so most explicitly. Slogans like the right to difference, he declared, contribute to the idea that we're still not entirely French. We are still separate. I don't want the right to difference. I want the right to indifference. Je ne veux pas le droit à la différence. Je veux le droit à l'indifférence. That is to say, I don't want people to pay attention to me. I want to be forgotten. It took me a long time to understand what Farid meant, but I think his claims have significant implications for political theory and political action. I don't want to reduce the assimilationist position by most mainstream Republicans to the far more inclusivist politics of recognition framework, but thinking through Farid's claims makes one realize how both positions continue to mark Islam as a sign or practice of difference in and from France, of difference. While certainly more open to public Muslim religiosity than assimilationist republicanism, the right to difference position continues to privilege a very traditional idea of France that positions Muslimness as a form of difference or otherness from the norm. Though seemingly opposed, then, these two political paradigms share the binary of assimilation versus difference. They diverge only in thinking about how to manage Muslim difference. The former calls for assimilation, the latter for limited recognition. In other words, even an ostensibly inclusive politics recognizing Muslim difference reproduces certain ways of being and thinking as different and leaves dominant norms and assumptions intact. Farid bypasses this binary entirely. By insisting on his right to indifference, he invokes his right to be unremarked by others, yet on terms that do not require his assimilation into majority religious, cultural, and racial norms. In so doing, he departs from both the dominant assimilationist framework of Republican integration and the emerging framework that proposes instead to recognize Muslim difference. Farid attempts, in other words, to reframe the current debate about so-called Muslim difference, and his attempts resonate with many Muslim French. In contrast to the politics of Republican integration, which demands that Muslims restrict their particularity, in this case their religiosity, to the private sphere, Muslim French like Farid seek to publicly inhabit their non-normative identities, conventionally understood as their difference. Yet in contrast to a differentialist politics, they do not want their difference to be recognized as such. What Muslim French like Farid call for, then, is the indifference to difference, such that difference is neither abstracted nor overdetermined, rendered neither invisible nor hypervisible. Muslim French demand the right to be visible but unremarkable, put simply, the right to be. Although the term unremarkable may seem an odd choice of word on my part, it captures, I think, both the Muslim French desire to be unremarked upon, as well as the desire to represent an unexceptional occurrence in French public space, their Muslimness, an ordinary form of being French. Horia Boutelja, a founding member of the Radical Natives of the Republic Party, put it this way: "We want the right to be ordinary. On veut le droit d'être banal." That desire to be ordinary propels many Muslim French to claim the public practice of Islam not as a right to difference, but rather as an entitlement of equal citizenship. instead of occupying the place of difference within a more tolerant and inclusive France, the kind of positioning imagined by many North American and French public intellectuals who have called for the recognition and accommodation of Muslim difference as the solution to the cultural and political marginalization of Muslims, rather than occupying the place of difference, Muslim French argue that they are not different, but rather French. For those activists theorizing explicitly about the right to indifference or the right to be ordinary, that right takes two specific forms. The first is best exemplified by Bouteja, who referenced her right to banality in the middle of a conversation about homophobia among Muslims. Bouteja was quite frank about the casual homophobia she ascribed to much of the Muslim Maghrebi community, but she wanted to know why this homophobia was any more problematic than that of any other community, and why Muslim homophobia should constitute a citizenship deficit rather than merely a form of intolerance in a way that Catholic or Jewish, or I would add secular Republican, homophobia does not. After all, almost half of France opposed the recent legalization of same-sex marriage without anyone accusing them of being unintegrated or not proper citizens. In asserting the right to banality, then, Bouteja was insisting that homophobic attitudes among Maghrebi origin French, just as criminal or delinquent acts by citizens and residents of Maghrebi descent, should not be treated any differently from forms of homophobia, criminality, or delinquency practiced by Français de souche, or native French. She was questioning, in other words, why problem behavior like homophobia on the part of Muslims or Franco-Maghrebis should signify a lack of Frenchness and consequently provoke the threat of expulsion, when similar behavior on the part of non-Muslims, including a large part of the center-right UMP party and the Catholic Church, remain utterly unremarkable. The second, somewhat different articulation of the right to indifference concerns the right of Muslims to participate in French society and shape its general interest as much as any other citizen. As Eunice of the Collective of French Muslims, or CMF, declared, and I quote, "If one is a French citizen of Muslim faith, that means that all spaces of dialogue, of debate, of social transformation, all these spaces concern us," unquote. Unlike Bouteja's notion of indifference, then, which seems to demand the indifference to difference but leaves intact the organization of center, i.e. white France, and periphery, i.e. the spaces of discrete ethnic, religious, and racial difference, Eunice, as well as most of the Muslim French activists I knew, seek to disrupt the very notion of difference itself, understanding difference not as deviation but as variation. In other words, they imagine the national polity as cross-cut by a multiplicity of differences without any essential form of non-difference or majority. Eunice's spatial metaphor, "all these spaces concern us," collapses the distinction between general and particular and between center and periphery that undergirds both the Republican model of integration and the differentialist politics of recognition. Eunice's declaration has two connected meanings. First, as he explicitly announces, Muslim French can and should intervene in French society as a whole and not only in their particular communities. And second, he implicitly argues that even when acting within their own particular communities, Muslim French are always already intervening within France more broadly, since Muslim French are by definition French. So there is no more particular anymore. In articulating the political vision of Muslim French, and I just want to put this back up because I just think it's super interesting. In articulating the political vision of Muslim French, I find it helpful to reflect on American political philosopher Danielle Allen's distinction between the metaphors of oneness and wholeness in conceptions of the nation. Though oneness is often used as the main metaphor to describe a people or a nation, one people, one nation, Allen instead proposes the metaphor of wholeness. The commitment to oneness, she argues, has often entailed practices that make citizens who are not part of the one people politically invisible. Wholeness offers a different vision, she contends, since the word whole can encompass multiplicity in a way that one cannot. Many Muslim French, I want to propose, share a similar vision of the nation. Countering the oneness-oriented France propagated by most Republicans, a oneness inscribed into the French Constitution, which affirms the Republic as one and indivisible, many Muslim French envision the community of citizens through the metaphor of wholeness. That polity is a space that cultivates heterogeneity rather than homogeneity, including the possibility of radical and incommensurable heterogeneities. Imagining the republic as plural explodes the national polity into various cross-sections of equally different differences in a way that fundamentally undoes the existing configuration of identity and difference, majority and minority, center and periphery. Difference is conceptualized not in relation to a center, which no longer exists, but rather in relation to various other identities or differences, such that non-dominant ways of life can be recognized without being classified as essentialized difference. This also means that there exists no essential identity either against which difference is measured. So difference and identity are entirely relational. By refusing an a priori center and periphery, majority and minority, identity and difference, the polity envisioned by many Muslim French also refuses, almost by definition, any stable or unified political formations. Explaining the CMF's alliances with other progressive groups, Yunus told me that there are bridges that can unite disparate groups. For example, he continued, and I quote, "For me personally, on a religious level, I'm not going to defend gay marriage. Even if you say it's universal, I don't share in this universality," which is an interesting thing to say. "On the other hand, if you say to me, we're going to fight for equal treatment between men and women, I agree. We're going to fight for equality between rich and poor nations, okay. That is to say, I have my corpus of references and I find bridges with others. We'll fight together at least according to the minimal values that we share," unquote. My goal here is not to defend the anti-same-sex marriage position of Yunus and the CMF, nor to imply that all Muslim French are anti-same-sex marriage. Like the rest of the French population, Muslim French were deeply divided on the question. What I want to highlight, rather, is how Muslim French activists like Yunus often work with various progressive groups, including queer collectives, on specific projects, even though they do not share the same agenda across multiple political terrains. There are certainly difficulties that have to be negotiated in these spaces of radical heterogeneity, and my final chapter, I think that you had read, discusses this. But I want to underscore the extent to which Muslim French like Yunus reject any a priori notion of political unity or oneness in a way that radically disaggregates the political itself. And I would add that their ethical and political capacity to work with those who provoke discomfort, including queer rights collectives, often shifts their own moral and ethical attachments. Instead, Muslim French like Farid, Yunus, and Huria embrace a future of ad hoc political formations that by definition cannot unite everyone, that constantly shift into new political constellations, and that encompass, at various times and across various issues, different parts of the whole. In so doing, and I'll conclude here, in so doing, they defy existing analytical and certainly political conventions for thinking about Islam and the West, and they open a future of unexpected possibilities that it seems to me have yet to unfold. Thank you.